that video because this is an assumed knowledge at your level. Another thing is, when you are answering exams at your level, I understand you are doing assignments, but I need to emphasize on this. When you are answering exams at your level, definitions do not kill marks, or even knowledge of models, it doesn't kill marks. Like a situation where you say building blocks says they should be dimensions, standards, and stuff, in as much as they are writing that, it doesn't carry marks. When you are saying DMAIC methodology talks about define, measure, analyze, improve, and control, that doesn't carry marks. If you are defining what balanced scorecard is, and then you say it comprises of four perspectives: financial, internal business processes, learning and innovation, as well as customer perspective, that doesn't carry any marks. So what then carries marks at your level is your ability to relate to the case. You know, all SBA, all strategic business as strategic professional level subjects, the main emphasis is on application. Rarely do we give you marks for writing your opinion, which is independent of what we have given you as the case in the case. Always know that you need to relate to the case. Everything that you are saying, can it be found in the case, or can it be a reasoning around something, a logical reasoning around something which is given in the case? It's so important. Now, let us proceed on today's discussion item. Though today's discussion item is not that long. Perhaps it may be long because at some point we may be doing a question. Allow me to open an Excel booklet like this one. Measures of predicting and, I mean, approaches to predicting and measuring corporate failure. Approaches to predicting and measuring corporate failure. There are quite a lot of ways you can actually use to measure corporate failure. You can use quite a lot. The basic ones, which you have been doing from all level to date, it's ratio analysis. You know, there are quite a lot of ratios on corporate failure, which may imply the firm's inability to operate as a going concern. And these ratios may include liquidity ratios, gearing ratios. That's number two. Gearing or solvency ratios, Now, these are some of the ratios that you can use, and another is leverage ratios. You can actually use leverage ratios to predict corporate failure. Leverage means the amount of fixed costs that the firm has, the amount of fixed costs that the firm has. That's what we refer to as leverage. So you can, you know, if you have got quite a lot of fixed costs, like in this scenario of lockdowns, in this scenario of COVID locked COVID-19 lockdowns, if your business is exposed to quite a lot of fixed costs, there are chances that these fixed costs may actually threaten the very survival of the business. We do have what is called operational leverage. Operational leverage. Some call it operational gearing. A measure of corporate success or failure. Now, what do we mean by operational gearing? This measures sensitivity of EBIT to a change in sales. Sensitivity of EBIT, earnings before interest and tax, to a change in sales. That's operating leverage. So it is like this. If you are using operating leverage to measure performance, you say operating leverage equals you calculate it as contribution over EBIT. That's how you calculate operational leverage. You know, where EBIT equals contribution less operating fixed costs. Operational leverage. There is operational leverage, and you give your answer as in times, so it will be like XX times. So for the higher the operational leverage, the more risky the firm is. The higher the operational leverage, comma, the higher the risk of corporate failure. So if you have got quite a lot of operating leverage, it means you are financed to a great extent by fixed costs. So should things go bad, chances are you are exposed to the risk of corporate failure. That's operating leverage. E.g., an operating leverage of two times implies that if sales change by, say, 10%, EBIT will change by 20%. So it will be 10% times 2, which is 20%. So that's operational leverage. Why is it if sales change by 20%, by 10%, EBIT will change by 20%? It's because some of the costs are fixed and they don't change. So because costs are fixed, it means the impact on EBIT will be huge, because some costs, they don't change. So if rent is 2 million, it will remain 2 million. So you get it. Even if sales decrease by 10%, rent will not decrease. So these are quantitative methods. These are quantitative. You know, ratio analysis is actually under quantitative methods of predicting corporate failure. So we do have that. And so this is Operating leverage, and then there is financial leverage. Financial leverage. Financial leverage, some call it financial gearing, still the same. You know, these measures, sensitivity to this measures sensitivity to, I mean, sensitivity of earnings to equity holders, earnings to equity holders following a change in EBIT, change in EBIT. That's operational gearing. You know this, you should know this because we discussed this in FM. It's not like it's an APM thing. Please know that. I am simply bringing it here because some of you have a tendency of forgetting, or you were exempted. You don't even have a clue of what this is. Yet this is something that is being expected that you know this. Notice I'm busy giving you definitions, but I told you definitions don't get marks. Application is what matters. So operational leverage, you calculate it as follows. I mean financial leverage, you say equals EBIT over EBIT minus interest. Over EBIT minus interest. That's how some may calculate it, or some may say operational leverage equals debt equals, you know, may measure operational leverage as debt over equity. I mean financial leverage as debt over equity. Or I mean, or any other measure. Any other measure. The examiner will tell you which measure is appropriate under the circumstance. That's financial leverage. A higher financial leverage exposes the firm to the risk of corporate failure. The higher the financial leverage, the higher the risk of corporate failure. The higher the financial leverage, the higher the risk of corporate failure. And again, financial leverage is measured in times. The answer you get there is in times. So the commonly used ratio is EBIT over EBIT minus interest. That's a commonly used measure of financial leverage, or you can measure it as debt to equity ratio or any other measure. You get that? Now, other quantitative models of predicting corporate failure are these. Let me open something just so that I can just present with that information at hand. Okay. Right, let me try to open this. I just want to show you something. Let me open.
Right?
So here you go. I told you that there is a technical article on. I told you that there is a technical article on complex businesses. And do you still remember what I said are complex businesses? Munya? Munya, do you still remember what I said are complex businesses? Is that all right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what are they?
It's a business that maybe that you have connections with different businesses, or maybe, for example,
Okay. What I'm getting is you understand it. It's a networked business, a boundaryless organization, business which is run on the whose strength is on the basis of external relationships, be it through franchising, be it through licensing, be it through, you know, having outsourcing of raw materials, outsourcing of processes. It is, we call that a complex organization. So understand that. So complex, so concerning complex organization, this is a straightforward thing, because normally it's like joint ventures. All these are complex organizations. There are performance measurement issues in all this. There are performance management issues in all these complex organizations. Virtual organizations, they run virtually, as the name suggests, you know, but still they are complex entities. Supply chains in complex entities. So now, as you can see, you are being referred to the technical article. So no wonder why here I didn't take time to teach you. I just say, please read that technical article. It is the same technical article we are talking about here. It's the same technical article. So all you have to do is to, I'm sure you are following, you followed my instructions where I said, please go on that technical article and read it. So important. Complex organizations, like there are supply chain issues. When someone is supplying you raw materials and you assemble these raw materials or components into a final product, so there's need to make sure that there are quality agreements there. The partners, the networking partners, are reliable in terms of quality, responsiveness to the agreement specifications, etc. And okay, so everything here is from that technical article. Don't, when we say read this, please make sure you read it. Now, quantitative models of predicting corporate failure, quite a lot. They are quantitative. As I said, the ratio analysis is one of them. It's one of them. So we were discussing leverage. So let me proceed with my quantitative models. Actually, on top of ratio analysis, let us write quantitative models. Quantitative models of predicting corporate failure. And another is what is called the another ratio is another is what is called Z-score. Z-score was a model which was it's a Z-score model of predicting corporate failure. Yes, it's like being a model, meaning all you have to do is to come up with input variables. The model itself has got room for input variables. It was a model which was designed in early stages around 1964, 1950s and 60s. You know, the model basically is like this. It's like this. This is the model. Z equals. So what you have to do is to put these input variables. Like X1 is working capital over total assets. X2 is retained earnings over total assets. X3 is earnings before interest and tax over total assets. X4 is market value of equity over liabilities. X5 is sales over total assets. So once you put those figures here, you come up with the answer. No wonder why we call it model. All you have to do is to put to input the variables and you get the answer. Now the implication of the answers that you get is the Z score of less than 1.8, it would imply that the company is at high risk of corporate failure. If the Z score is less than 1.8, it would imply that the company is facing a very high risk of corporate failure. You get that? But if the Z score is 3 or more, it would imply that the firm is healthy, is in a healthy state. Now, what if the Z score is between 1.8 to 3? What if the Z score is between 1.8 to 3? This is called a gray area. A gray area meaning we can't tell whether the firm is facing the risk of failure or whether the firm is facing is in a healthy state. More information needs to be done. More information needs to be gathered and analyzed to come up with a recent conclusion as to whether is this firm really facing the risk of corporate failure. So Z score was another quantitative method, the quantitative models, one of the quantitative models of predicting failure, what corporate failure. Once again, a score less than 1.8 implies that the company is at high risk of failure. A score above 3 implies that the firm is operating success, is in a healthy state. In between, it's a gray area. So the model itself is not conclusive. If your model says, I can't conclude if the figure is this, it means the model is persuasive. It's not conclusive because it has got an outcome which is called gray area, where additional information needs to be gathered before we have a definitive conclusion, right? So you can calculate the Z score there from the figures. You know, you get these from financial statements. All quantitative models are obtainable from the financial statements. They are obtainable from financial statements. So what you have to do is to input variables. X1 is this, X2 is this, X3 is this, X4, X5, and you input in Z score, you notice that here the answer is 1.85. Now, if the score is 1.85, it would mean that it's in a gray area. We can't conclude whether the firm is facing corporate failure or not. Now, here are the main disadvantages of quantitative models of predicting corporate failure. You know, by quantitative models, meaning the use of ratios from the published financial statements to predict corporate failure. So the advantage, of course, is that research suggests that quantitative methods are accurate in predicting corporate failure. And they are also objective. You know, objective meaning figures are there. We are not necessarily guessing. We are not guessing. We are using figures which are there. Some of these figures are actually audited. Now, the disadvantages are cutoff points might be inappropriate or even they might change over time. So what it means is if the financial statement is for the year ended 30 November 2020, you know, these are the published financial statements we have. There might be a situation where a company's financial statements ended 30 November 2020 and this company yet a major oil spill and government said The company is to pay a penalty of 15 billion to clear the damage on the environment, to rectify the damage on the environment. How then? So clearly this penalty of 15 billion might be huge to the extent of actually forcing closure of the firm. But this happened in December after the financial year end date. So events which occur recently, which have got impact on the firm's performance, like a scandalous behavior, like death of the CEO, like any other major acquisition, an event which has occurred after the financial year end date might be significant to the financial or operational health of the firm. So these events are ignored in the quantitative models because we don't change financial statements to reflect these new events if they have occurred after. Some events are non-adjusting events. So under the circumstances, quantitative models, then the cutoff might not be appropriate, or it might not capture all the events. Models focus on symptoms rather than causes. As I always say, these are financial models because they are based on results presented in financial statements. And you know, financial statements are results or symptoms of whatever we have been doing. So financial statements are merely results of whether the firm is doing it right or wrong in various aspects of performance, which can be measured in non-financial terms. You get it? Then another is, bankruptcies can be caused by factors not shown in the financial statements. As I have just said, financial statements can be manipulated. Yes, you know, especially this issue of profit statements, they can be manipulated. Now, in mitigation of, to mitigate the problems of quantitative models, there is this issue of, there's then this issue of qualitative models. Qualitative models, they basically ride on the limitations of quantitative models in that they focus on qualitative aspects which contributes to corporate failure. The key drivers of value in a company, which if not addressed, will result in corporate failure. And one of the commonly used qualitative model is the Argenti score. Argenti score model, or we call it A score for Argenti score. Now, the model says corporate failure is a sequence of dimensions in a firm which need to be paid attention to. For example, if there are a lot of defects in a firm, they lead to mistakes, and mistakes result in symptoms, and these symptoms are what quantitative models then measure. So defects are like inherent problems in a company, like an authoritative board, like a passive board, a board which does not even respond to environment, an inagile board. Those are called defects. So it will be like this. Argenti score, actually, if you can see this, if I can zoom it in, let me try to zoom it in and see if it works. Right. So this is the Argenti score. What it says is, there is what we call defects. Defects like CEO is autocratic. CEO is also the chairman. The board is passive, meaning it's a reactive, not a proactive board. We have a weak finance director, poor management depth or insight about the company, no budgetary controls, nothing, no cash flow plans, no costing. If you have got these defects, they lead to mistakes. And mistakes might be, because you don't have all this, you might now end up having mistakes of having high gearing, over trading, meaning putting a strain on your working capital, or undercapitalizing your working capital. And then big project that has gone wrong because there's no budgetary controls. We don't even have a systematic approach on capital budgets. When this has happened, it then leads to symptoms, and symptoms are now what you then measure in financial terms, like you can use Z-score or other ratios, or symptoms may now lead to creative accounting, trying to spice up financial statements for them to look better. So Z-score says the score is 100. Now, if you have now the Z-score, I mean the Agenti score, sorry, the score is 100. And now if for interpretation of the agent score is the opposite. Interpretation is, for the agent score is opposite. It says when it is less than 18, actually when it is less than 18, if the agent score is less than 18, no worries. No worries. But of course, when it is now approaching 18, there's need for anxiety. If it is between 18 to 25, if it is between 18 to 25, it's a gray area. 18 to 25, it becomes a gray area, meaning it's a warning sign, but we are not yet definitive. If it is above those, the gray area, of course, 30 and above, we say, it's in perfect health. I mean when it is above 30, we say it is facing the risk of failure. So notice Z score says less than 1.8 high risk of failure. Agent score says less than 18, meaning just multiply by 10, less than 18, no risk of failure. So it's the opposite. Z-score says over 30. It's a financial health. It's a financially good health state. Agent score says above 30. It's a risk of failure. 18 to 25. Some textbooks simply say AC 18 to 20. They then say it's a gray area. Even in agent score 1.8 to 3. It's gray area. So for you to understand the interpretations of these models, normally we give you in the exam because they are models. So don't claim them. Don't even claim them. We give you. Advantages of agent score, as we have said, it focuses on non-financial indicators, which is it focuses on causes, not symptoms. You get that? Another is you need to make sure you have classified things right, like is this a mistake, is this a defect, and then you know they are saying misclassification rate of 5% has just been estimated. In other words, it's more accurate, so to speak. Now problems are it requires judgment. Sure, it requires judgment because when they are using non-financial stuff, it's not, they are not objective. They are unlike others. Financial information is usually audited, so it's objective. These ones now, it's a matter of judgment. Like, are you saying the CEO is autocratic? That's a judgmental thing. It only takes into account internal factors and does not indicate an expected time frame. Later models are more sophisticated. In other words, there are some models of agency which are rather very, very sophisticated. So, you know, performance strategies for corporate recovery. Now, if you want a firm to recover from the blink or from the brink of corporate failure, there are, you know, it all boils down to pivot strategies. You need to rescue the company from corporate failure. Now, improvement strategies are basically, you know, if you find reasons for corporate failure, address those reasons. So if you find agent factors for corporate failure, the causes, attend to those. Like, so if you want to recover, immediate or remedial action is to identify causes and investigate them. You can do that by, the causes might be given from the agenda score, for example. Seek external advice, because most of these, they focus on internal. Whether financial or non-financial, they merely focus on internal. So you have to seek external advice. If there's need to introduce, say, technology, make sure you get that as soon as possible. Be prepared for major strategic change. In other words, drastic changes might be required. Put in controls to prevent further problems. Like, there are no budgetary controls, there are no cash flow projections, there's nothing. Make sure you rectify those. You get that? Then on your right, there are factors to turn around an ailing business. An ailing business is a business which is finding difficult to, you know, it's on the brink of failure. So what are the factors to turn around? These are called turnaround strategies, like strong leadership, introduce tight controls, liquidate non-current assets, which is a tying up cash but are not generating any cash, and then utilize that cash to pursue other profitable ventures. You have a robust and aggressive marketing plan. Restructure your debt, meaning seek agreement with creditors to reschedule payments. These are turnaround strategies. And then there are business changes, like operational changes. Operational changes, like focus on ways to reduce overtrading, the risk of overtrading, like cash flow management, you know, key strategies for turning the company around and monitoring the KPIs operationally. Remember, operationally means short term. Yeah, if you ignore short term performance improvements, you are actually neglecting long term performance improvement as well. So you have that. Okay, so these are like now examples. Now, as I have said, there's a technical article on that. Actually, when it comes to APM, there's technical article on almost every topic, save for a few. Save for very few. But there are quite a lot of technical articles. So, this is what I wanted us to discuss. But in summary, really, what I want you to know is this. Factors, I mean, usefulness of the model. Evaluating the usefulness of the model. How do you evaluate the usefulness of the model for prediction of corporate failure? Because if it's one thing to get a model and it's another to rely on it. Because you might rely on a model with insufficient information and then at the end of the day, there might be problems. You look at one, recency. Recency. Actually, by recency, we are saying that the model incorporates recent events. Does the model incorporates recent events? Result in corporate failure. So important. Recency effect. As a model, does it really incorporate? So listen on this one. The points I'm giving you are just the points. So if we give you a case study, you don't write them like this. You refer to the case study. I have told you that the model must incorporate recent events. But we give you a case study and tell you that this is how the model is calculated. So you need to tell the examiner that as this model is from past financial data and recently there was an event 2 weeks ago, It is not factored in the model. You have to relate, you know, succinctly to the case. Identify the, you know, don't just say the model must incorporate recent events and think that there is a mark for that. There's nothing. If you don't relate that point to the case, there's nothing. There's no mark. There's no mark. Another is you look at objectivity. Objectivity. You know? So you can say normally, comma, quantitative models are based on quantitative models are based on audited financial information. Based on audited financial information. Financial information. And are deemed to be, they are then deemed to be, you know, objective. They are then deemed to be objective. This is a very important point. They are deemed to be objective. Now, if they are qualitative models, they might not be objective. Another thing is, or still on objectivity, you can say qualitative models are largely subjective. Qualitative models are to a large extent subjective. To a large extent subjective. You get that? Another factor that you consider is representation, is the model representative of the company? Is constructed on factors, constructed based on factors which are representative of the company. Right. So the bottom line is like this, e.g. A Z score was constructed using manufacturing firms. A Z score was constructed using performance of mining firms. Performance of mining firms, it might not be appropriate to farming industries. It might not be appropriate to, you know, if a Z-score was constructed using performance of mining firms, it might not be appropriate for banking firms, banking industries, banking business. Because they are totally different. So you need to understand, before you use the model, always understand it. Then another thing is, conclusivity of the model. Now, you know, we know that Z score and Argenti score, A score, have outcomes are called gray areas, which are called gray areas. where further research is required. Further research is where further research is required. Required, implying that they are not 100% useful. Implying that they are not 100% useful. You get that? Then there is availability of data. That's another factor to consider, the availability. Availability of data. Availability of data and its reliability. And its reliability. You know, if a model uses market values of equity, like if you come to Z score, you'd notice that on Z score there is market value of equity, X4. So what it means is, if a company is not listed on stock exchange, that information might not be reliable. E.g., Z score uses market value of equity. Market value of equity. Such data might not be available, might not be available in unlisted firm and must be reliably estimated and must be reliably estimated. You know, I can say quite a lot of things, but generally is what I've been what we are reading is advantages and disadvantages. But you need to understand when you are evaluating usefulness of a model, this is what you look for. Another thing is number six. Does the model incorporate both symptoms and causes? So important. Does the model incorporates both symptoms and causes of corporate failure? You have to understand, does the model really incorporate both symptoms and causes of corporate failure? If your model leaves out some, e.g., quantitative models ignore causes, whereas Z-score considers both. Whereas A-score considers both. Another is number seven. Does the model take into account factors in the external environment or not? You have to consider all this. Let me end there on factors that you consider when you're evaluating the usefulness of a model. Now, notice, Munya, these factors, if you you write them in an exam without relating to the model we have given you, after you have written a point, if you fail to go into the case and relate to the model that we have given you, all the points we have written will not carry any marks. All of them, they will not carry marks. After you have said, does the model take, you need to consider whether the data is available. Then if the model in the case is Z-score, you tell them, you tell the examiner, like say, the X4 in the Z-score given requires market value of equity to be used. And the company in question is unlisted. Now, the fact that this company is unlisted, then we may end up actually coming up with value of equity which is not reliable because it's not easily available for an unlisted company. That's the answer. Not just to say, is the data available and reliable? That's not a point because it's not applied to the case. You need to every point, you know what? If you want your life to be easy with ACCA, never write a point without application. You're wasting your time. Never write any point, no matter the expedience that point may prove to give you. Never be tempted to write a point without its application. It's so important. It's so important. Never write a point without its application. So this question, I want us now to do question number, let me send a question paper. Right. The question paper is September 2018. Right. There you go. Let me open it also here. Number two, Freeze Company. Read it. Just give me a minute, I'll be back. Right, I'm back now, so let us read. Frieze Company is listed on the small Kaland Stock Exchange. Now, if they say it is listed, it means the figures are available and reliable. Because normally for a listed company, companies will produce audited financial statements, which attest to relatively availability and reliability of data. And supplies construction services to oil exploration industry in Kaland. Demand for Frieze services broadly relates directly to the world oil price. A recent fall in world oil prices has led to several corporate failures in the oil exploration industry, as the exploration of new oil fields becomes unprofitable. In April, a major oil spill led to environmental damage in Kaland. Initial investigations has indicated that the cause of the oil spill may be due to incorrect installation of machinery by Frieze. So there was oil spill, and oil spill they are saying our machinery is likely to be the cause. Quantitative failure model. So there is what is called the K-score. Now, what happens in an exam is when a student realizes that there is K-score, they freak out. They begin to say, we have never heard our say talking about K-score. Our say used to talk about Z-score and A-score. No. Remember, the stock exchange is Kaland, so they have a K-score. So even if you come across K-score in an exam, it does not mean it's now a new model. No. Remember, your exam is case specific. Whether you are hearing it for the first time, because your exam is case specific, there is no textbook you will ever read and come across K-score. So you can't say we were not given enough exam practice because you didn't come across K-score during lectures. K-score is the score for the K-land, and just you now know what to look for from any quantitative model. So it doesn't matter whether the examiner gives you Z score for Botswana, you are given B score. For Lesotho, you are given L score. It's still fine. The K score is a qualitative model based on predicting whether freeze is at risk of corporate failure. This score was developed by correlating recent historic data on financial ratios of all companies listed on the stock exchange. The model calculation is shown in Appendix 1. So you'll be told how to calculate K-score. So it's not even your baby to bother yourself much. So you go to Appendix 1 right away. Here's how K-score is calculated in Appendix 1. K-score equals 2,5 K1 plus 5 K2 plus 0,1 K3 plus 1,9 K4. And K1 is net current assets over total assets. Remember, net current assets is current assets minus current liabilities. Know that. Net current assets is current assets minus current liabilities. We should not have debates on this one. K2 is profit before interest and tax. This is what is called operating profit over total assets. K3 is market value of ordinary shares. Now, if they say market value of ordinary shares and they put this small 2 here, most students ended up squaring it, thinking that it was market value of ordinary shares squared. No. That small 2 here is simply telling you that there is point number 2 in the notes where you get market value. It's not even saying squared. So when they say market value of ordinary shares and then they say 2, they are saying come to point number 2. Now, the average price of Freeze ordinary shares on the K-Land Stock Exchange for the year ended was $10.60. So they are simply saying you say number of ordinary shares times $10.60. When they say market value, they are not saying market price. $10.60 is the price. So what is the market value of the ordinary shares? You multiply the price $10.60 by the number of shares to get the market value. And then if a K score is 2 or less, it means corporate failure is highly likely. Whereas if it is 5 or more, it indicates that corporate failure is unlikely. The scores between 2 and 5 are a gray area, meaning further analysis is required. Are you noticing that even if you are to get a model for corporate failure in an exam, it's not an excuse for you to say, I haven't come across it when I was reading. We can't give you all the models. It's not possible to give you a model which is used in Malawi, the Malawi score. We can't be giving you all models to say for you to say, yeah, I'm now ready for the exam. Even if we give you a model right in the exam, which you have never had, you must still get that question correct. It's not an excuse to say I'm coming across it for the first time. So you have got financial information for Freeze. This is for Freeze, and another company is called Thor, but we are dealing with Freeze. So all these ratios, you get them from these financial statements. They are saying they were approved on 31 March. Notice, financial statements were approved on 31 March 2008. And oil spill happened when? The oil spill happened in April 2008, just barely a week or so after approval. So in other words, K-score is based on reported financial results. It does not take into account recent results, recent information. Like our financial statements were approved in April on 31 March, and a week later there was oil spill and Freeze was argued to be the problem. Now continuing, a colleague of yours, now they are saying corporate failure indicators and competitor information. This is now for another company. So a colleague of yours who is an academic working in K-Land University, he suggested that operational gearing and financial gearing. So there are another methods of of measuring corporate failure, operational gearing and financial gearing are the two most important indicators of corporate failure in the industry in which Freeze operates. To demonstrate this, she has introduced you to Thor, which is a privately owned. Remember, Freeze is public owned because it's listed. This one, Thor, is privately owned, but it is based in Jayland, which is another country. Thor provides similar services to Freeze in both Kayland and Jayland oil exploration. So a company called Thor is in Jayland, but it provides services also in Kayland. Thor reports its financial statements in Jayland dollars. An economic recession has recently begun in Jayland. So you notice, I said the model should take into account factors in the external environment. So there was a recent economic recession in Jayland. Extracts from publicly available accounts of Freeze and Thor for the year ended 31 December 2007 are both shown in Appendix 2. For comparison purposes, both are in Kayland dollars. Now, question number one. Evaluate the usefulness of the quantitative K-score model in predicting the corporate failure of Freeze and Thor. Evaluate, meaning if you want to know whether Freeze and Thor are at risk of corporate failure, if we are to use K-score, how useful is it? The question is evaluate, meaning critical analysis and coming up with a logical judgment. That's evaluation. Now, I gave you factors to consider. Recency effect. Does the model incorporate recent events which may result in corporate failure? You look at that. Objectivity. I'm sure you were writing this. And I said, normally, quantitative models are based on audited financial information, which are deemed to be objective. Qualitative models are largely subjective. Then another point is the model constructed based on factors which are representative of the company? So you'll be told how the model is constructed. Like in this case, you are actually told, how is the K-score constructed? Remember, Freeze is into oil exploration. Now, K-score is developed by correlating recent historic data on financial ratios of all companies listed on the Kayland Stock Exchange with the incidence of subsequent corporate failure. So in other words, K-score was developed from all companies on Kayland Stock Exchange, which eventually ended up in failure, which had a high propensity of failing. Right? You look also at, I said you also look at conclusivity of the model. In other words, does the model give us results which are conclusive? If the model say this is a gray area, it is actually telling you that we can't give you all the information you need. So you need to research further. That's what it means. Conclusivity of the model. Is the model conclusive? That's what we are talking about. Another is availability of data. Of course, if it's private, limited, data might not be reliable, though available. If it's public, limited, it might be reliable. Another is, does the model incorporate both symptoms and causes? A case score is based on financial statements, meaning it is based on symptoms. Does the model take into account factors in the external environment? We are told that there is a recent recession in Jayland. So if you are evaluating failure for Thor, does this necessarily incorporate that? I want to leave you discussing this. So I'm just giving you points to discuss. Then I want to hear you discussing. Using only Freeze's case score for the year, assess whether Freeze is at risk of corporate failure. So you use this case score here, but calculate ratios for Freeze from the information given in the financial statements. And what else? Evaluate your colleague's suggestion on the most important indicators of corporate failure in the industry, and using these indicators, assess whether freeze is more likely to suffer corporate failure than thaw, meaning evaluate using operational gearing and financial gearing. So you have to tell us what operational gearing is. Calculate it for freeze. Calculate it for thaw. Interpret it for freeze. Interpret it for thaw. I gave you how operational gearing is calculated in the introductory parts of the question. Another is calculate financial gearing. And for financial gearing, notice they have given us how to calculate it. They are saying financial gearing, then 0.1. So here, financial gearing equals preference share capital plus long-term debt over total equity. Preference share capital plus long-term debt over total equity. Because I told you the examiner can give you any other way to calculate it. Now, notice that total equity means ordinary shares plus other components of equity plus retained earnings. Added together, they give you total equity. You get it? So you define what operational gearing is, financial gearing is, calculate it for both companies, comment on the implications of the results obtained, and then conclude by telling us which of the firm is at a higher risk of experiencing corporate failure from the operational gearing and financial gearing. Now, let us all unmute and begin to answer questions A, B, C. You'll be going back to the case. Let us do that, guys. Please, actually, let me stop the recording. Because as far as the recording is concerned, divisional performance and transfer.